pursuing life as a follower of Jesus Christ, I have found over the years that there are, broadly speaking, probably at least three primary hurdles each of us need to cross in that endeavor. The first hurdle is probably the hurdle of faith itself, of belief itself, of coming to the point where we actually believe in God and we trust in the provision of His Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, for our forgiveness. And, that process of coming to that point can take a few days or a few years, depending upon our circumstances. But that's one of the first hurdles we need to cross, is just that hurdle of faith itself. The next hurdle I would describe beyond coming to faith itself is understanding that this newfound faith that we have discovered in terms of our belief in God and trust in His Son is something to build upon. It's something that we grow in, and it's not something that we grow in passively. It's not something that God sort of just magically does stuff. He invites us to be a participant with Him, to cultivate the soil of our hearts and lives in such a way that this new relationship is something that grows deeper, that grows stronger, that grows more significant, that allows us to experience God in a personal way, in new and varied ways, and to do so takes upon ourselves the responsibility to pursue that. And in Methodist world, we talk about various means of grace that allow us to do that, the reading and hearing of the scriptures, of prayer, the receiving of the Lord's Supper, our baptism and remembering the baptism, all of these things that we participate in to allow us to grow and develop in this faith and to grow in the grace that we discover in our newfound faith. So we have a hurdle of faith. We have the hurdle of understanding that it is something to grow in, but particularly that we have a part to play in achieving that growth. And then I would say the third hurdle is the hurdle of understanding that each and every one of us also has a contribution to make. That we are not just receivers, but we have something to share as well. That by virtue of our faith and by virtue of our growth and our relationship with Christ, each and every one of us has a ministry, has a purpose, has a contribution to make within the life of the local church and even beyond the local church and community around us. And that can vary somewhat according to our gifts and according to our spheres. And everybody's ministry doesn't look the same, but according to the Bible, everybody has one. Sometimes it takes a bit before we realize that, yes, I too can make a difference by virtue of my relationship with God and the life of other people. And as we talk about those hurdles in here at Harvester, we've tried to, basically, our mission is to help people like you and me basically get over those hurdles. And we've captured that in a mission statement that defines who we are and why we're here, that over the last few weeks we've actually been taking a look at. It's actually listed in your bulletin each and every week. It's on the page that has the information about contact information. You might want to take a look at that right now. But basically, this is our attempt to basically answer a very basic question, why are we here? And why do we do what we do? According to this very basic mission statement, it simply says that Harvester Church exists to invite people into a growing relationship with Jesus Christ. We flesh that out a bit by defining that as welcoming people just as they are into a loving and diverse community and nurturing people by teaching them to follow Jesus and to genuinely care for one another. Beyond that, to equip people to get involved in God's work and serve others and seek out people to share Jesus' love with. Now, what we've been doing the last few weeks is taking that mission statement and revisiting it a bit, because I think, well, for those of you that might be somewhat new to Harvester, it'd probably be a good exercise to give you even a better flavor of who we are and why we're here. And for those of us that have been around a while, well, it never hurts to remind ourselves with some degree of frequency the answers to that question and how that weaves its way out in our lives. And the way we've been doing that is simply ask this question: If Jesus were working on this mission statement, how would He go about doing it? How would Jesus go about inviting people into a relationship with Him? How would Jesus welcome people and help them grow? How would Jesus help people discover and find that each of us has a ministry, a contribution to make in the lives of other people as well? And there are a lot of different stories from the life of Jesus that we can go to look at each of those. And Obviously, we don't have time each Sunday to do that, but we have taken time to look at least one, and that is what we're going to do again this day, and I invite you to follow along while I read this passage from the book of Matthew. Jesus traveled through all the towns and villages of that area, teaching in the synagogues and announcing the good news about the kingdom. And he healed every kind of disease and illness. And when he saw the crowds, he had compassion on them because they were confused and helpless, like sheep without a shepherd. He said to his disciples, "The harvest is great, but the workers are few. So pray to the Lord who is in charge of the harvest. Ask him to send more workers into the fields." Jesus called his 12 disciples together and gave them authority to cast out evil spirits and to heal every kind of disease and illness. Here are the names of the 12 apostles. First Simon, also called Peter, then Andrew, Peter's brother, James, son of Zebedee, John, James' brother, Philip, Bartholomew, Thomas, Matthew, the tax collector, James, son of Alphaeus, Thaddeus, Simon, the zealot, and Judas Iscariot, who later betrayed him. Jesus sent out the 12 apostles with these instructions: "Don't go to the Gentiles or the Samaritans, but only to the people of Israel, God's lost sheep. Go and announce to them that the kingdom of heaven is near. Heal the sick. Raise the dead. Cure those with leprosy and cast out demons. Give as freely as you have received." In this passage, Jesus begins is doing basically what we're, by this point, if you have followed the life of Christ, that we're accustomed to him doing. He's traveling the countryside. He's teaching and preaching to people about the kingdom of God, and he, as he has occasion to do so, is healing those who are sick. This is kind of standard procedure for Jesus at this point, and these are things that have gathered by this point in his ministry a certain level of attention, so that as he proceeds around the countryside, it's not that difficult for a crowd to gather because the word has gotten around and people are very curious about this Jesus, this person who comes and whose teaching seems to be the same and yet in some way different than what they've been hearing before, and also someone who seems to have a unique power to bring healing into the lives of those who come see him. And so that's pretty typical stuff. But this is a very, 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 very pivotal point in the life and ministry of Jesus and in the life and ministry of those who are following him. Because Jesus makes an observation about these crowds of people. He says that he has compassion. He says they are like sheep without a shepherd. And then he goes on to explain that the harvest is plentiful. There is no lack of harvest, but there is a lack of harvesters. Now, we're not necessarily talking about our church this morning, but there's some correlation here. We can always use more. There are a lack of harvesters. There's a plentiful harvest, lack of harvesters, and therein lies a problem for the ongoing work of Jesus. For even the Son of God seemed to, for whatever reason, recognize the fact that in his earthly experience, at least, there were limitations to what he could do. And one of those things was he needed more people doing exactly what he had been doing. And so he makes this observation about people. What is the harvest? Well, the harvest is simply people who are ready and willing to respond to the message and the truth of Christ, to receive his ministry, if there was at least but someone who is willing to bring that to them. There's a lot of work that goes into getting to the point of harvest. I grew up in the upper Midwest where cornfields and wheat fields are common, and there's a lot of work involved in getting ready for the harvest. There is cultivating and there is tilling, and there's a lot of work that comes prior to the harvest that's very, very important, without which there will be no harvest. And so that all goes in. But when the harvest time comes, there is a very small window of time in which the harvest needs to be brought in. For as the corn, the wheat, or whatever is being harvested is ripened, there's a small window of time in which that needs to be picked, and it needs to be siloed, or it needs to be processed, or it needs to go where it needs to go. And because of that small window of time, a larger number of workers are needed at that point than at any other point in the cycle of an agrarian culture. I mean, we see this here too. If you go out to Eastern Hillsborough County in about a month, strawberry season comes upon us. The strawberries are growing now, and obviously a lot of work has gone into it. You'll see many, many people out in the field because why? It's harvest time. It's harvest time. Jesus says in his day, the harvest was plentiful. There is a harvest to be had if there were simply more harvesters to enter in the work and seek to accomplish the work that God has done for them. So what's the solution? Well, first of all, he invites his followers to pray. Ah, there's an idea. He says the first thing, the first step is pray that the Lord would send more harvesters into the harvest fields. And why is that important? Well, because most people don't choose to do this apart from the prompting of the Holy Spirit within them. Most of us tend to feel, well, we're not qualified or enough, or I don't have enough time, or my particular skill set isn't, quote, a spiritual skill set. Or, the list can go on and on and on. But our self-analysis tends to say, this is an endeavor for, well, people like you, Pastor. People that have had a certain level of training. People who have a call. People who, I don't know, talk a certain way, act a certain way, know the Bible better than I do. That's kind of goes into it. And that's therein lies why one of the hurdles that we have in this pursuit of being a disciple of Jesus Christ is this wonderful discovery. Not only can I know him, not only can I grow in the relationship, but I can make a contribution to other people experiencing the same thing, despite what I think of myself. Why? Because ultimately it's the power of God working in and through me. You know, God didn't make a mistake when he made you the way he did. God didn't make a mistake when he gave you the particular skill set that he gave to you. God didn't make a mistake when he gave you the particular passions and interests he had. God didn't make a mistake when he planted you in the particular family that you find yourself in, or the sphere of relationships that you find yourself in. God didn't make a mistake with any of that stuff. You are exactly who he wanted you to be, and you are exactly where he wants you to be. The only issue is understanding what he wants to be able to use you for in the midst of all that. And that's what I think is behind Jesus saying the first step is here, pray. Pray that God will capture people's hearts in such a way that they will understand that they are part of the answer. They are really the answer to the question of needing more harvesters. Now, nowhere can that be more seen when we look at what he does. Now, if you're reading this in print, the scripture that I read this morning, you'll notice that there's a chapter break here between chapter 9 and chapter 10 of the book of Matthew. Now, some of you may know, and some of you may not know, that these chapters, the numbers of the chapters and the verse numbers, those were added many, many years, in fact, many, many centuries after the scriptures were originally written down. They were added for a very good reason, so that we can find stuff. And that we can help one another find stuff. And so they were reference points to find certain things in the book of Scripture. Very, very useful tool. The downside, so to speak, is sometimes they interrupt the flow. And because there's a chapter break here, sometimes we don't connect this need for workers and Jesus' prayer for workers with what he did next by actually empowering workers and a particular set of harvesters. Jesus called his 12 disciples together. He gave them authority to cast out evil spirits and to heal every kind of disease and illness. He goes on to say that he sent them out. This is a pivotal point in the ministry of Jesus. It's a pivotal point in the lives of the 12 disciples. See, up to this point in time, they had come in some semblance, even though they still had questions and still obviously were growing in their faith, they had come to the point of faith. They were believing and trusting in Christ, and they were growing in that faith. But for the most part, they were following Jesus around and observing him do the work of the ministry. Now, there were a lot of lessons they were learning during this time by observing what Jesus was doing and the conversations that Jesus would often have with them following a particular event or circumstance or teaching opportunity, but they pretty much were spectators. They were along for the ride. It was a good ride. It was an important ride. They were a learning ride. But to this point, now things are about to change. Because Jesus is about to tell them, what you have been learning from me, I want you to now turn around and I'll go do for others as well. And therein lies how Jesus goes about doing this. Now, lest you still think that you don't have a place in the work of God, that there is not some place in the life of the church where God can use you, let me mention and remind you of this particular group of people that he says has the power and has anointed them to go out and do these good deeds. The first four, Simon, Andrew, James, and John, well, they're two sets of brothers. And they also happen to be fishermen. There's nothing wrong with being a fisherman. But typically, fishermen would not have perceived themselves as people who have any right or ability to teach anybody else about God. In fact, probably in their minds, they were thinking, why would anybody expect a fisherman to have any particular knowledge about God anyway? It's interesting to me that when Jesus anointed the first group of people to extend his ministry and to empower them to go out and do what he had done, he didn't go to the religiously educated group of his day. He went to probably the most common, ordinary, everyday, hardworking people, probably rather rough people in terms of life's experience. And these are the people that he not only called himself, but he empowered to begin to transport and convey the message that he had brought to other people as well. And so the first four, you know, I'm not saying that fishermen should be proud. I mean, I like my fish dinner as much as you do, and someone's got to go catch it because, folks, I don't know how to fish. Good. And I know some of you do. But I've tried fishing, and the fish just laugh at me. They know I'm not a fisherman. I mean, even the fish can tell I'm not a fisherman. So, trust me, fishermen are important people. But there again, it's not necessarily the people you would decide that would be empowered to preach the gospel. Now, let's go on a little bit. Philip, Bartholomew, Thomas. Oh, there's one. Now, some of you that have read your Bibles and know the story, even if you don't know the story per se, you've heard the term of what? Doubting Thomas. Ah, this is the guy that even after Jesus had been raised from the dead, was demanding some sort of proof that it had really happened. And that it was very, very difficult for him to take it upon faith. Now, personally, just so you know, I think Thomas gets a bit of a bad rap. You know, I think Thomas was much more on board. I think he asked a very reasonable question. After all, people don't usually come out of the grave once they've gone into it. And so for Thomas to ask for a bit of evidence, I don't think is really that outlandish. But nevertheless, that's what history called him. Thomas was one of those, well, I identify, maybe this is why I identify him. He's a Midwesterner. He says, prove it. I'll buy it. Just prove it. Show me. And so I get Thomas, but nevertheless, here's a guy that had to be convinced time and time again of the truth, and yet he's one of these people that Jesus... Matthew, he's the guy that's actually the human author of the book that the passage comes from. Matthew, and he self-identifies himself as the tax collector. Now, we've talked about those folks a lot here and how unliked they were and deservedly so in the culture. But here's one that is not only included in the list of those who had faith in Christ, not only listed in those who had grown in their relationship, but listed amongst those who are going to be entrusted with the power of Christ to go proclaim the message of Christ and extend his work on earth, the tax collector, James, Thaddeus, Simon. Oh, Simon, the zealot. What's a zealot? Well, you may have heard the word someone who's very zealous. It means someone with a lot of enthusiasm, a lot of focus, high level of commitment. Zealots in Jesus' day were a particular group of people. You could put a capital Z in front of it. It was, if you will, a political party. This guy here, Simon the Zealot, he was a political extremist, if there ever was one. He would have been somebody that some people could possibly have labeled a terrorist in our day because he was a political extremist, and his particular party was pushing for the political and forceful overthrow of the Roman government that they perceived oppressing them. And yet here he is not only a follower of Jesus Christ, but one that Jesus Christ is saying, this guy, too, I'm going to empower. Now, and then, Judas, who what? Later betrayed them. He's in the group, too. Now, all that is to say is, what's your excuse? I mean, if these are the folks that Jesus says, I'm going to anoint and give authority to bring my message, to bring my work, to be the conveyors of the love and mercy and message to other people. What's our, I mean, you can't find a better, more motley group than this. And with them as well, they see, he didn't just say, go do this. He said, go do it together. If you read on a little farther, he sent them out in pairs. Can you imagine this zealot guy being paired, say, with one of the fishermen? You know, I mean, it would have made for very interesting conversations. The commonality was their experience with Jesus Christ that cut across all those boundaries of their backgrounds, of their vocations, of their political bent, of their lack of faith or great faith, whatever it was. It was this common experience that it all had with Jesus Christ, and then Jesus Christ said, it is enough. You have the, you've learned, you've got a lot to learn yet too, but you've learned enough where you can begin to pass it along to others as well. So what does he do? He sends them out. He sends them out. Pivotal point. Now, they've been traveling with Jesus before. His first point. First time where he sends them out, but he didn't go with them. Not in the physical sense. Jesus said, I'm going to send you. I'm not going with you this time. I'm not going to be physically present when you preach and when you heal and you do all, I'm not going to be there with you this time. Do you think they're a bit nervous at this point?
Yeah.
I mean, think of some of the things they've been through with Jesus. At this point, they're a bit nervous because they're feeling alone. Now, granted, he's given them authority, and so they are obviously a little bit nervous. So, in order to prepare them, the whole rest of chapter 10 is basically giving them some instructions. So that they're not caught totally off guard when they experience certain things when they get out there and start preaching and teaching. We don't have time to read all the instructions. I just want to mention a couple of the first ones. He says, he sent the 12 apostles out with these instructions. He says, don't go to the Gentiles or the Samaritans, but only to the people of Israel, God's lost sheep. Why would Jesus say that? Does God only care about the nation of Israel? No. In fact, at the end of Jesus' life, before he ascends to heaven, he specifically says, I want you to take the message to begin here in Jerusalem, and I want you to go to Samaria, and I want you to go to the Gentiles, and I want you to go to the ends of the earth. Why does he say this? And essentially, I'm going to say it's a matter of timing. First of all, Jesus understood that his primary initial mission were the people who had received the written promises that their Messiah was coming. That this would be the group of people, supposedly, who would be most receptive initially to hearing the message of Christ. And Jesus understood that that's where he began, primarily. That's where he invited them to begin. But here's the lesson I think there is for us, is he's not asking them, initially at least, to go somewhere else. Just do it with the people you already know. Start there. He's protecting. He's not laying upon layers. Says, "Okay, I got. If I'm going to be a minister of Jesus Christ, that means I got to be a missionary in some god awful place in the world that I would hate to be living in." I mean, that's. And so he says, "Just do it where you're at. Do it with those you know. Start there. God will expand the circle in His time, but begin simply in the circle that you know." And he announced to them that the kingdom of heaven is at hand. Heal the sick, raise the dead, cure those with leprosy, and cast out demons. And then he says this, give as freely as you have received. In other words, what is it they're supposed to give away? They only have to give away what they have. He's not asking them to have an education in systematic theology. He's not asking them to even totally understand all that the Bible has. He says, you've received freely from me, give it away freely. I've given it to you. Just give what you've got. Give what you've got. Now, I'd suggest to you this morning, there's some pretty good lessons in there for those of us who maybe have come to faith in Christ, that we understand and are participating in the means of grace that are allowing us to grow in Christ. But we haven't crossed that hurdle quite yet. We'll begin to realize that we can be used of Christ in a significant way and experience what the disciples said. Because I will suggest to you today, until you begin to realize that not only Jesus is someone
to believe in. Jesus is not only someone to grow in relationship with, but Jesus is someone who empowers me to make a difference in the lives of other people. You really haven't experienced the full orbit of what it means to experience God and all that He has for us. It's deep in the hearts of every one of us. I believe God has created the desire for our life to count for something, someone. God says in this passage, it does. He needs more harvesters. Who are they? They're tax collectors, they're zealots, they're fishermen, they're whatever. They're you and me. They're you and me. And God simply says, begin with your act. Take what I've given you, share it with others. You can do that in the context of the church. We have a variety of ministries. Obviously, we have folks that lead worship on Sunday morning, people that have particular gifts and passions to do that. And amongst them, there's probably a few tax collectors and zealots along the way. We have people that need to go back there in that sound booth and tech booth and make sure that that stuff all gets turned on and turned off and adjusted accordingly. We have children's ministries. I realize that at the 9 o'clock crowd, we don't think about the children's ministry as much because many of you here today are folks that your children are grown. But one of my prayers is that there be people that maybe whose children are grown that as a gift to those who are still raising children so that they could sit and worship each day would volunteer at least some of the time to be in the room with the kids from the 11 o'clock service. Just a thought. And no, you don't have to have a degree in early childhood education to work in children's ministry. We have someone on staff who has one of those. They can teach you everything you need to know. And so there's opportunities there. Youth ministry, working with teenagers, young lives. I can't think of anything more significant. I realize there are certain things as significant, more significant than investing in the next generation. Folks, collectively, we have the opportunity and capability to invest in new people. You have that opportunity to do that. We have groups like congregational care and evangelism and outreach that help prepare us and equip us to care for one another and to extend that care outward into our community. These are all opportunities. We have administrative roles. We have these wonderful group of people called trustees and finance people and staff parish relations, who help us kind of make sure the organizational structure of the work goes. Trust me, folks, there is a place for you to serve in this church. And if you don't think it is, you come talk to me, and I'll get you in touch with somebody, and we'll find you a place that fits you. But here's the thing. One thing has not changed in 2,000 years since Jesus told this story. The harvest is still plentiful. The harvest is still plentiful. There are still people who need and are anxious to learn about the Lord Jesus Christ if they have the appropriate opportunity and if there was someone who was willing to bring that to them. The other thing that hasn't changed is the workers tend to still be too few. The workers tend to still be too few. But I believe that this story tells us it doesn't have to be that way. Because God wants to use me. God wants to use me in all our frailties and all the issues that somehow to cross that hurdle that says it's not just about faith, it's not just about growth, but it is about serving and seeking those whom Jesus came for as well. Father, we thank you.